This morning's responsive reading is from the sixth chapter of Luke. Coming down off the mountain with them, he stood on a plain surrounded by disciples and was soon enjoined by a huge congregation from all over Judea and Jerusalem, even from the seaside towns of Tyre and Sidon. They had come both to hear him and to be cured of their ailments. Those disturbed by evil spirits were healed. Everyone was trying to touch him. So much energy surging from him. So many people healed. Then he spoke. Count yourself blessed every time someone cuts you down or throws you out, every time someone smears or blackens your name to discredit me. What it means is that the truth is too close for comfort, and that person is uncomfortable. You can be glad when that happens. Skip like a lamb if you like. For even though they don't like it, I do, and all heaven applauds.
It happens. I heard about a Sunday school teacher that told his class about the story of the rich man and Lazarus. He highlighted Lazarus' good ending and the rich man's terrible ending. He pointed out that one man went to hell and the other went to heaven. He also pointed out how rich one man was and how poor the other one was. After the teacher taught his lesson, he asked the class, "Now, which would you rather be, the rich man or Lazarus?" One boy raised his hand and said, "Well, I'd like to be the rich man while I'm alive and Lazarus when I'm dead." Wouldn't we all? Of course, for many who take the name of Jesus, that would be their choice too. But there are some realities in life, Christian life that is. For example, if we try to put each of our 2 feet in different camps, we will be enemies of both. And if we are honest, while we might prefer to have it both ways, that is not the teaching of Jesus. In the story of the rich man and Lazarus, we know that the rich man has wealth, prestige, and success. He appears to be living the good life, and probably in his circle of friends, he has it made. But the story tells us something different. The result of the lives of the rich man and Lazarus is a considerable role reversal. Today's scripture suggests a role reversal for believers and that following Jesus, or not, has significant consequences. Yet perhaps we're not ready to live with all the implications. After all, we're all seeking an easy life. For his followers, Jesus warns that life probably won't be what they want. Listen to his words that you just read. You're blessed when you've lost it all. God's kingdom is there for you, the finding. You're blessed when you're ravenously hungry. Then you're ready for the messianic meal. You're blessed when the tears flow freely. Joy comes in the morning. Count yourself blessed every time someone cuts you down or throws you out. Every time someone smears or blackens your name to discredit me. It means that the truth is too close for comfort and that that person is uncomfortable. You can be glad when that happens. Skip like a lamb, if you like, for even though they don't like it, I do. And all heaven applauds and know that you're in good company. My preachers and witnesses have always been treated like this. Now that's Eugene Peterson's translation. And I wonder how we would respond if we stood in that crowd that day when Jesus was speaking. Be honest now. I believe that most of us would try to find a way around making the sacrifice. We want things easy. And every decision, every innovation carries with it consequences. When you make life easier, there are consequences. Sometimes it makes it harder. That's a sermon for another day. Just think about life. In the early 1900s, most people had two sets of clothes. Everyday clothes, work clothes, and Sunday go to meeting clothes. That was for the rest of the time. They probably had a change of everyday clothes because they had to wear something when the wash was being done. Even in the late 1950s, I can remember my grandmother used a wash tub and a canoe paddle to do the wash. She was comfortable with it. And her determination would not let her move beyond the tried and true. So she used her canoe paddle rather than one of the labor-saving washing machines. Do you remember searching for a new home? And the bedroom closets were just a little wider than the door and only about 18 inches deep. When Fran and I in 1995 went out to look for a house, the first thing that we did when we bought the house was to address the size of the closets. Now, we're much more modest than many folks. We have a small, narrow room in the front of the house that's in the eaves. And some of my friends said, "Oh, this would be great to make into a closet, and my wife would fill it all up." I actually built smaller closets for Fran and I. And yes, they're all filled up. But here's an interesting factoid. Studies indicate that it took just as long in the 1990s to do laundry as at the beginning of the 1900s. Think about that. Making the job easier resulted in the task not being so labor-intensive, but certainly didn't shorten the time consumed, regardless of what the brand of laundry detergent or the machines were. More closet room ultimately means a broader selection of clothing. So while we made it easier, we didn't shorten it because we have more things that, you know, instead of wearing the same set of clothes all week, well, you wouldn't do that anymore, would you? Technology can ease the labor intensity, but not require less time than a simpler way. For instance, you know, you guys all know that I am an early adapter. So, you know, I had an electronic scheduler back in 1996. And I keep my phone at my side all the time. It's good for a lot of things, but I find that one of the things that I don't do, if I'm sitting in my office reading and I want to take a note, I don't pull out my phone. Rather, I'd rather use the old method than try to dictate on my phone. Because ultimately it takes time to correct the errors that my learning digital assistant has when she can't understand what I'm saying. So there are times when dictating is more accessible, but more time consuming. But our faith choices matter. They have consequences. The sermon explains how Jesus' followers can expect to be treated. Jesus doesn't invite them into a life that has no challenges, nor does he promise us such a life. No, the Christian lifestyle puts our desires aside to favor God-honoring choices. Being a Christian is no easy walk in the park. It challenges us and changes us. Accepting the call of Jesus has enormous consequences and rewards, so making correct and good choices is essential. Following Jesus is life-changing. Maybe that's what was appealing to those first century followers of Jesus. They didn't have an easy life before they were invited to have their lives transformed. And if you were a woman or a child, you particularly had it difficult. Unlike men in the first century, women and children only had value as property. Slavery was considered a usual way of life. If you had the financial resources, you could purchase a person to work for you. If you did not have the financial resources, were a child or a woman, you could be sold into slavery at common slave auctions that basically were in every city. And a child born female was often abandoned by her family and left outside to be consumed by wild animals. It's not a pleasant picture. Life wasn't pretty except for the privileged men. They had all the power. Not that they didn't respect their families. There are many examples of the importance and the generosity and the influence of men in the early church relating to the inclusion of women. We see that in the letters of Paul. You know, in 1 Corinthians, in Ephesians, where Paul talks about the marriage covenant, and he talks about men and women, he really elevates that. What he says there about women being subject to your husbands, you know, isn't very popular in weddings these days. But for the people in the first century, it was liberating because he said, as unto the Lord, and men, honor your wives. No more throwaway wives. And while enslavement was not like plantation slavery in America, persons on the auction block had few rights unless they lived in a free family. So what attracted people to Jesus? The life he offered was better than the life they experienced. People followed Jesus for different reasons. First, living in occupied Roman territory was difficult. Soldiers were everywhere. They could require you to carry their equipment for a mile by merely selecting you as they passed you on the road. Hey, Gary, carry this. Second, tax collectors, their only accountability was to pay the high taxes the emperor required from citizens of occupied territories. And what did those taxes do? They funded and supported the army that occupied their land. And then that's all that the tax collectors had to pay. frankly, it paid for the expansion of the empire and the occupation of their lands. And because that was all they had to pay, they had no, there were no guidelines about how much more they could charge for their services, so they could double the tax. It was high enough to begin with. And they could collect whatever they wanted. Remember the helpless Zebulun and Naphtali we discussed last week? Occupied territory. Third, citizens were equally vulnerable under the Roman occupation forces, though there are some safeguards in place. For instance, a Roman soldier could require a conscripted person to carry their pack, but not more than a mile. Now let me ask a simple biblical question. Where do we hear about Jesus addressing that in the Gospels? Do you remember what the story is? What his teaching is?
He said, go 2 miles.
Yeah, Jesus said, if somebody requires you to go 1 mile, you go 2 miles. Now, there's some discussion in scholarly circles about what the intent of Jesus was doing, because if you went 2 miles, the Roman soldier got in trouble because he was abusing you. He couldn't let you do that. So there's that, but there's also what Jesus is saying to us, I believe, is listen, you're called to go beyond because that's your lifestyle. That's what it means. If somebody asks this of you, do it and do more. So you can go 1 mile or 2 miles. Jesus says, hey, stop complaining about it. Go the extra mile. Now, going the extra mile would require a change in attitude for the person being asked to do it. Think about yourself walking down the road. Roman soldier comes up, or he comes up from behind you and says, hey, you, Mike, come over here and carry this. And you do it. And you do it probably somewhat begrudgingly because you had some agenda. You may have even gone someplace. It didn't matter. You did it. To go the extra mile takes a complete change in attitude. Challenging? Yeah, it is challenging, isn't it? It means putting aside pride and anger and not complaining about what needs to be done. And in the first century, Christians find that changing attitudes is in itself challenging. Living Jesus' teaching is difficult, but they change lives and disrupt usual inclinations. Who wants to be forced to do something we would rather not do? But Jesus says we should willfully comply and put our desires and our wills on the back burner. The first person to reach billionaire status was a man who knew how to set goals and follow through. At age 23, he had become a millionaire. And by age 50, a billionaire. Every decision, attitude, and relationship was tailored to create his personal power and wealth. He was known for his ruthlessness in building his companies. Nothing and no one would be able to compete. But at 53, 3 years later, he was ill. His entire body racked with pain, and he lost all the hair on his head. In complete agony, the world's only billionaire could buy anything he wanted, but could only digest milk and crackers. An associate wrote, he could not sleep, would not smile, and nothing in life meant anything to him. His personal, highly skilled physicians predicted that he would die within the year. That year passed agonizingly slow. Then as he approached death, he awoke one morning with a vague remembrance of a dream. He could barely recall the dream, but knew it had something to do with not being able to take any of his successes with him into the next world. The man who could control the business world suddenly realized he was not in control of his own life. He was left with a choice. He called his attorneys, accountants, and managers, and he announced to them that he wanted to channel his assets to hospitals, research, and mission work. On that day, John D. Rockefeller established his foundation. This new direction eventually led to the discovery of penicillin, cures for malaria, tuberculosis, and diphtheria strains. The list of discoveries resulting from his choice is enormous. But perhaps the most significant and amazing part of the Rockefeller story is that the moment he began to turn the focus of his life to something or someone other than himself, his body chemistry was altered so significantly that he got better. It looked like he would die at 53, but he lived to be 98. Rockefeller learned gratitude and gave back from his wealth. Doing so made him whole. It's one thing to be healed, it's another to be made whole. John D. Rockefeller was made whole and then cured. Like Jesus' word to the 10th leper, our faith, not wealth, popularity, or service, changes us. It's faith. Jesus said it. Your faith has made you well. Just before the pandemic started, I shared the story of Laura's story. Laura's story reminds us that blessings do not always come from good times. And I think that's what Jesus is saying in this sermon, the Sermon on the Plain. In despair, struggling with challenging health conditions of her husband's brain tumor, Laura wrote that blessings sometimes come in ways that don't particularly feel good at the time, but are ultimately blessings. She wrote in her first significant song, "What if blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears?" Let's hear just a little bit of that song. What if 1,000 sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? What if trials of this life are your mercies in disguise? You see, the promise is that despite the difficulties, There is more to life than doing it our way. Putting God's will ahead of our desires and preferences changes us from the inside out. It may be immediately challenging and uncomfortable when we take the focus off ourselves, but we know the end of the story for those who follow Jesus. For some people, that transformation is instantaneous. When I started my ministry, a parishioner shared his experience of quitting smoking years earlier. He had been addicted for quite a while. He went to see a friend of his in the hospital, was disturbed with that friend's lung cancer, and the friend was a chain smoker. While he was driving home, this parishioner, after that visit with his friend, who was dying of lung cancer, he decided to quit smoking. As he drove home, he opened his car window and threw out his only pack of cigarettes. And he said he never bought another pack, never asked for one, never bummed one. It was over, instantaneous. That happens for some people. But Jesus goes further. He tells us we should rejoice because he likes that kind of behavior, that is, that change. It's the way we are supposed to live as servants. And for others, transformation is a process that requires time. My own call to ministry story is not about a Damascus Road experience. No, it happened over a series of weeks. And over that series of weeks, the call became louder. And louder. And louder. Until one Sunday morning, worshiping in church, it was very clear to me that Christ was calling me to be in full-time Christian service. So not only people who take Jesus' names not spared of difficult times, Jesus is clear that following him could cause difficult times, and that the transformation for us could be slow or could be quick. So with those terms, who should be a follower of Jesus? Many have considered it and turned down the invitation. To understand the call, people need to comprehend that there is more to living the good life than gratification, compensation, and status. Jesus promises more, and throughout the centuries has delivered more. In Jesus comes the assurance that I'm not alone, no matter what happens to me. One of the common things that happens to us as we age is we find that the folks we've been close to disappear one at a time. And we get to the place where we wonder. I've seen that often in my ministry. And struggling with it right now with my 101-year-old aunt. Why am I here? Why am I here? That's a good question, isn't it? Why are you here? Are you a follower? Jesus gives us the assurance that we're not alone, ever, no matter what happens to us. In Jesus, that assurance is that we are loved. I know that I'm loved. And I have to admit that in my life I've had some difficult times, and it's only that kind of understanding that got me through. In Jesus is new life that offers forgiveness and release from guilt. Jesus provides the only way family conflict and wars will end. Neighbors will find ways to get along because life in Jesus is based on loving others, treating others respectfully, and serving Christ through serving others. Following Jesus, following Christ, is not without drama. We've never been promised that. We have been promised life because by living the way of Jesus, the way of the cross, we have decided to follow even through persecution. And the reward is life with Him in eternity. Will you accept the invitation into the kingdom? Will you renew your commitment to Christ? He's waiting on you with open arms and loving arms. Let's pray. Jesus, we come to you because you promise us hope. Sometimes, though, Lord, you call us to do things that just feel uncomfortable and wrong. They probably are wrong by our standards and practices, but those same actions are characteristic of your kingdom. Forgive us for our hesitancy. Take away our fear and reluctance to give up those things that are contrary to your will for us. Help us accept the grace you extend and move into your kingdom. Guide us and strengthen us through the sacrifices you call us to make as we change our behavior. We pray in your name. Amen. Now, I don't know where you are on your spiritual journey, and it doesn't matter. I want to invite anyone struggling with worry or disappointment, questioning your faith, or facing a difficult decision to a time of prayer this morning as the service closes. Maybe your life is a mess, your future is uncertain, or you're looking for direction for a big decision. Let's take it to the Lord in prayer. Whatever is on your heart, on your mind, or keeps you awake at night, we're here for you. God is here for you. And Jesus invites you to join us. Come when and if the Spirit leads you as we sing the final hymn.